Good afternoon. My name is Lynn McBee, and I chair the Bridges Board of Directors, and I am so happy you're here with us this afternoon. Welcome, and thank you for coming down for our special celebration. I want to do a special shout out to the Dallas Street Choir for that amazing performance. That really sets the tone for this afternoon. We are here today to celebrate our 10-year partnership with the City of Dallas. Thank you, Mayor Rawlings, former Mayor Miller, City Manager T.C. Broadnax, Commissioner Teresa Daniel, Commissioner Elba Garcia, Judge Clay Jenkins, and City Council members in attendance. We also have so much gratitude for our generous donors, passionate volunteers, community partners, our amazing board. And if you're a board member, would you please stand and let us applaud you? This is the most awesome, dedicated group of folks I've ever had the pleasure of working with. We also have our amazing staff here that are in the trenches every day working with our guests. And I'd like to ask if you're a staff member of the bridge to please stand, because you are what's making it happen. Yay. With the support of all of you, the bridge has provided critical homeless recovery services to more than 40,000 guests experiencing homelessness since we opened 10 years ago. We have so much that we can all be proud of. First, the bridge has been recognized by the state of Texas as an exemplary recovery-oriented system of care and earned the international distinction of the Rudy Bruner Award for Urban Excellence for our innovative and inspirational campus design. We actively work with DPD and other partners, and as a result, serious crime has decreased in downtown Dallas by 55% since we opened. And homeless jail stays have also significantly decreased that have saved on taxpayer dollars. And finally, I think we all know how much the Cedars neighborhoods and farmers market have exploded. I think you will agree with me that this public-private partnership is vital to the City of Dallas. I would like to recognize key foundations and major supporters that are in attendance today. Thank you to the Meadows Foundation, the Mike and Mary Terry Foundation, the Reese Jones Foundation, Barron and Blue Foundation, the Moody Foundation, the Communities Foundation of Texas, Dallas Morning News Charities, and many other supporters. We simply could not do our work without your support, and we thank you. Before I introduce former Mayor Laura Miller, I would like to read a special letter from President George W. Bush, who was instrumental in the creation of the bridge, through his call to action to all U.S. mayors to address the homeless epidemic across the country. Greetings to those gathered in Dallas, Texas, to celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Bridge Homeless Recovery Center. Congratulations on this special occasion. In 2003, Mayor Laura Miller boldly responded to a call to action to develop new ways to solve the homeless crisis in America. The citizens of Dallas supported her vision and deployed its armies of compassion to establish the Bridge Homeless Recovery Center. 10 years later, I am proud that the Bridge has helped to create a more hopeful tomorrow for so many of our citizens. Laura and I appreciate Mayor Mike Rawlings and the staff and supporters of the Bridge Homeless Recovery Center. Thank you for your commitment to loving a neighbor and lending a hand to those in need. Your dedication to eradicating homelessness is admirable. Keep up the great work. We send our best wishes for a meaningful celebration. May God bless you, George W. Bush. It is now my pleasure to introduce the 58th mayor of Dallas, Texas, Laura Miller, who served from February of 2002 to June of 2007. Former Mayor Laura Miller.
Well, I am going to do you such a great favor and cut my remarks short because it's too hot for you all to be sitting there. But I did want to say that President Bush is much too humble because he had so much to do with us being here today. The federal government had an interagency program to tackle homelessness for many years when he became president, but it had its ups and downs. So the Reagan administration started it. H.W. Bush supported it, but Congress didn't reauthorize it in the Clinton years. And it was really George W. Bush, when he became president, who decided to make this a priority. He not only funded it, he staffed it, and he said, you are going to create a comprehensive plan to solve chronic homelessness throughout the country within 10 years. Very ambitious. He sent someone to Dallas who was very memorable. As Sandy Grayson will recall, Sandy and I were on the council together, as was County Commissioner Elba Garcia and 13 others. And he sent someone down who was striking for two reasons. He had a silver mane of hair, and he had a severe Yankee accent. And he said to us, you are going to be more aggressive, and you are going to help the homeless of your city. And we said, we will do it. Now, we had one extra practical reason for doing it, because we had something called the Day Resource Center that all of you NGOs will remember. And the problem we had is that the Day Resource Center was only open in the day, but it wasn't open at night. And the problem with the shelters is that they were open at night, but they weren't open during the day. So we had a big town hall meeting at City Hall, and we only invited our homeless citizens to come to the meeting. And we said, what is wrong with our system? And they said, in order to transition off the streets, we need to stop ping-ponging around between the shelters and the services, and we need a 24/7 place to go that will create a plan for us to transition to independence. That's what we need. And so the City Council decided to act. And in government years, we acted very quickly. So in 2003, we set up a commission on homelessness. In 2004, we selected a site, this site. And in 2005, we put $24 million on our bond package that had one item on it. Because if we had waited around for a bigger package, it would have been too much time had passed. So we put $24 million on one item, and we said, let's do this. Now, why did this all happen so seamlessly? Because 3 years after the bond package, we opened this facility. Why was it so easy to accomplish? Two words: homeless czars. Homeless czars. Now, I'll tell you why we needed a homeless czar. We had a meeting at City Hall after we decided to do this, and we had 30 homeless service providers. And you're all here, all the top 30 were there. And we said, okay, where do you want the facility? And we had a huge debate for 2 hours. And at the end, we had a straw vote. 17 NGOs wanted us to go to Industrial Boulevard. 9 wanted us to go to Malcolm X Boulevard. 3 wanted us to go to Harry Hines Boulevard. And 1 wanted us to go to the Decker Jail. County judge, just want you to know, we didn't go to the Decker Jail. So we had this fight, right? And we had all these smart people saying that they all wanted to go to a different place. And what do you do when you're the city and you've got a major problem that you can't fix? You call Tom Dunning. Tom Dunning is the nicest man in Dallas. And we said, Tom, you got to fix this. You got to get a site, you've got to get consensus, and we have to move forward. And Tom did that. Tom isn't with us today. He wishes he could be here. He sends his best wishes. But Tom was wonderful, and he brought the City Council and everyone to all the different sites, and we wound up here. So after he finished his work, he eased out of his role. And we needed someone else to come in who was equally wonderful. Now, there's a tradition in Judaism where our rabbis will say no 3 times to someone who wants to convert into our faith. And after the third time of saying no, then you know the person really wants to do it. He really wants to come in. So wasn't I lucky when Mike Rawlings said to me 3 times, I am not going to be the homeless czar? I was so optimistic because I knew he was going to do it. And on the 4th or 5th time, he said yes. So I want to bring to the podium not only the most wonderful homeless czar. He went to City Hall all the time. He met in the basement with all the engineers all the time, looking at the blueprints, making sure that this courtyard was the right size, making sure that there was a library and that there was a good intake facility and that there was a lot of space and that the homeless residents would be comfortable. And he cared very deeply. He went on the census counts himself to visit with people, to talk to people. He cared deeply, and he championed the bond package that allowed this facility to be built. And lucky for us, he didn't have too unpleasant a time doing it, because now he's the 60th mayor of the city of Dallas, Mike Rawlings.
Thank you. Thank you, Laura. You can tell she was a good salesman because I had done a lot of thinking, and Tom had wanted me to step in his shoes, and I said no. And I am so glad she was a great salesman because it was a wonderful experience, and it really helped me grow to a new part in my life. So I know it's hot today, but go back 10 years, okay? These trees were not this big. We did not have that canopy. This place is starting to come into its own, and it was about 10 degrees hotter than it is today. And I remember out there, my mother was sitting right there. The whole city council was there. It was a big day because they had worked very hard. I will tell you, our city council is committed behind this idea in dealing with a terrible scourge in this city with homeless, and I appreciate Sandy Grayson being here. I appreciate Adam McGue being here. We are committed to making sure that we follow through to the promise that we made the citizens of Dallas. It was a big ask, $24 million to build a building. And one item, as Mayor Miller just said, to get out. And it was my first time to put yard signs in yards and to fight the no vote and try to kind of make sure that we responded. Ultimately, the citizens of Dallas knew this was the right thing to do, and they came to the forefront and passed this bond. And I'll tell you, with the partnership that the city has shown, we have taken care of over 40,000 homeless clients and citizens in this city, and I'm so, so proud of what we have done. I must give a special thanks to Lynn, yourself, and to your board. This is a challenge to make sure that you take care of homeless citizens the right way, to make sure you meet the budgets, you deal with politics at City Hall, make sure all your funding comes from the state and the county. The county are important partners in this. And to make sure that the neighbors are seeing that they're partners here. And so each of you board members that are patient and are working hard on this, thank you so much for that. I really appreciate it. 10 years. We've got a lot of work to do, and we're gonna do it. There's a renaissance taking place, I believe, in this city and the county to work with our homeless citizens. We've got a new organization, the Dallas Area Partnership, with Teresa Daniel is a co-chair of. We have new folks here at the bridge. Dr. Woody, it's great to have you on board. We've got new folks at the city that are working on this. So a new team that's going to come together and I think make tremendous progress and build on the success that we've had in the past. But I'll tell you the one thing I learned, Laura, that we can deal with a lot of policy issues, we can deal with strategy, we can deal with money, but homelessness is a personal issue. These are men and women, not unlike ourselves, that have gone through difficult times, and they want a friend, they want a partner. And I'll always remember the individuals that I worked with that we made sure they got a bed and made sure they got a path to the next level. It was a tremendous gift to me. And so when I talk to somebody that was previously homeless, I get encouraged that this is an effort, a divine effort that we're working on. And one of the first guests to seek shelter here 10 years ago is Gerrie Hayes. Gerrie, with the bridge's help, was able to recover from homelessness, and now he's still at the bridge, but he is working here as a peer specialist. It's a wonderful, wonderful story. They struggle to move beyond their life circumstances and realize the past is not going to define the future for me. And I am so proud of Gerrie, what he's accomplished, but more importantly, what he can accomplish for the future. And he's the embodiment of what the bridge is about. So let's let the politicians stop talking, and let's let the guests start talking. Gerrie Hayes.
Thank you again, Mayor Rawlings. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gerrie Hayes, and I was one of the first guests to stay at the bridge when it opened 10 years ago. I am now a full-time employee at the bridge. I'll speak more on that later. Sometimes I wonder how I became homeless. Well, I really don't have to wonder. I fell on some hard times, and I came to the bridge for help. Well, I didn't really come to the bridge. Actually, the crisis unit picked me up. I want to shout out to them for helping save my life also. And they brought me to the bridge shortly after it opened. I remember the first day I arrived at the bridge, and the staff greeted me and offered me a lot of different services. The ones that stood out to me the most was the food, the showers, and the encouraging words. They told me I could do it this time. They offered me MetroCare services. From that point on, life started getting better. I started feeling better about myself, and I wanted to keep going, right? I wanted to keep doing this thing. Because of my positive attitude, willingness to work hard and on myself, I was offered transitional shelter at the bridge. I was one of the first men to move upstairs, and it was such an accomplishment for me, because I hadn't been in a bed in years, right? I was able to move on into my own apartment. Mind you, it was my first apartment. And I was able to maintain and be self-sufficient because of the lessons learned through the structure and the stable environment provided by the bridge, also known to us as the rules, right? Now it's 10 years later, and I find myself working the same place that believed in me and told me I could do it. My journey wasn't all unicorns and pink clouds, but because of the foundation given to me by the bridge, I kept working hard. My current supervisor, Diana Munoz, who I'd like to give a great shout out to, she's great. Actually, she was the first staff member to give me my mat and offer me a shave and a haircut. I can remember telling her how down and how bad I was feeling when I first got here. I remember thinking God wasn't going to do anything for me because I was so far gone in my homeless state of mind. And I always remember what Diane told me. She said, if that's the case, Gerrie, you're in luck, because God does his best work with the bottom of the barrel. And her words stuck with me. They stuck with me, right? It gave me hope. I was like, oh, right, great. And that's what I want to do while working here at the bridge as a peer support specialist. I want to inspire guests the way I was inspired. I want to let them know that they can do this thing too. I've met many guests like Terry Clemens, Diamond Martin, Sunday Scott, Mr. Presley, Mr. Tolliver, Mr. White, also Shannon, who have all shown with their hard work and dedication that they are defeating homelessness. I pray that you guys and all the guests continue to walk the path, become productive citizens. I want to thank everyone here today for giving me the opportunity to share my experience, strength, and hope at the bridge 10th anniversary. And last, and most importantly, Dr. Woody for believing in me and allowing me to be in service along with the bridge and helping others. Thank you guys again.
Thank you, Gerrie, for sharing and reminding us while we're all here and for being a role model and a mentor now in your work here at the bridge. Well, now it's my pleasure to formally introduce you to the bridge's newly named President and CEO, Dr. David Woody III. Yay. Dr. Woody began his service at the bridge in June of 2015 as Chief Services Officer, which included oversight of the programs and services for guests engaged in recovery from homelessness. He was then appointed Interim President and CEO in 2017, and he transitioned into the bridge's permanent position this past April. He has impeccable credentials, a bachelor's degree in sociology from Dartmouth College, master's degree in social work from New York University, and a PhD from Virginia Commonwealth University, as well as a history of providing and serving in leadership roles, directing a variety of services for the homeless populations throughout his career. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Woody to the podium.
Thanks, Lynn, for that introduction. A lot of times you hear those things, you don't, who is that they're talking about? That's not really me, but it's great that the board would make the choice for me to serve in this really important role at this very, very important time. First thing I want to do this afternoon is to recognize 11 dedicated employees who have worked here since 2008. I consistently remind folks of the choice one would make to work at the bridge and certainly to work with the homeless. So please stand when I call your name, and I'll ask the audience to hold your applause until everyone has been recognized. James Espinoza, Intensive Care Manager. Cynthia Garcia, Peer Support Specialist. Daryl Hinton, Peer Support Specialist. Monique Hughes, Recovery Care Manager. Heide Jahansus, HMIS Manager and Research Analyst. Sometimes you read these titles and like, who is this person? Are they really doing all this work? It's awesome. Kevlin Jenkins, Recovery Care Manager, Manager. Sokum Koo, Peer Support Specialist. Melissa Lewis, Recovery Care Manager. Diana Munoz, Peer Support Program Coordinator. Ann Thomas, Peer Support Specialist. And lastly, Aaron Turner, our Care Management Associate. Please give these folks a round of applause. That 11 folks would stay here since 2008 is a great example of a commitment to our mission. I'm hopeful that you would know we have concerned ourselves with basically two big things here at the bridge. Number one, that we facilitate recovery from homelessness. We are not simply a homeless shelter. Number two, that we are helping each guest identify a home. Folks who know me know that I consistently ask about what we get from our guests and how we partner with them in respect to crafting a care and housing plan. That is basically a roadmap that allows an individual to understand what it is that brought them into the homeless status, would bring them to our campus, and ultimately get them, hopefully, through recovery and into their own home. By now, you have seen our 10th anniversary logo. 10 years. During the time we spent designing it, visually, three words consistently popped up that exemplify who we have grown to be: recovery, impact, and community. Our focus on recovery is what makes us unique. While providing essential services, like a meal through our relationship with First Presbyterian Church, a hygiene kit for a shower, or like night shelter. These items will always be important components of the beginning of recovery. Our professional staff knows, though, that the bridge must offer a great deal more. That is why we have partnered with Parkland Health and Hospital System, Dallas Fire and Rescue, MetroCare Services, for example, to provide on-site access to physical health, mental health, and substance abuse services for our guests. That is why we partner with Texas Workforce Commission, the Veterans Administration, and various components of the City of Dallas to provide on-site access to employment assistance, job search assistance, connections to all benefits which one qualifies for, and most important, housing opportunities. That is why we hire highly qualified social workers and peer support specialists to assist guests through assessment of their immediate needs, assistance with managing day-to-day life, and crafting a housing plan. That is why we have a dog kennel on the campus, a barbershop on the campus, a library, laundry facilities, art classes, Narcotics Anonymous meetings, 12-step meetings, and other services right here on our campus. That is why we engage members of the Dallas community who would come alongside our work, volunteering their time, volunteering their treasures to facilitate our bingo, our karaoke, our storytelling early on Sunday mornings, library coverage, art classes, and other guest support activities. This is a one-stop shop. This is a place where a homeless individual can come to get their needs met. We remain committed to crafting the process for finding a way back home for each guest, demonstrating that they can truly recover from homelessness. We are establishing a foundation, ensuring we have the services and the partnerships on our campus to make recovery possible. That leads us to impact. How does one measure the impact of more than 4.7 million meals served, 227,000 care management sessions, 2,500 housing placements being facilitated over this time? Those numbers are impressive, yes, but our impact goes well beyond that data. We are improving the lives of our fellow citizens, citizens who are most in need of our help. The changes that they make reflect tremendous impact we have on our community. And that leads us to community. Before the bridge was built, where we are right now was a homeless encampment. Our downtown area was thirsting for rejuvenation, trying to attract more businesses and citizens, especially beyond traditional work hours. Crime was a consistent topic of conversation. Today, serious crime downtown has dropped 55%. The farmers market, that doesn't just happen. The farmers market is in the hands of a private company which invested more than $65 million to revitalize it. Thousands more people are living downtown. The farmers market neighborhood is one of the hottest places to be, with hundreds of apartments under construction and condos that were purchased for $200,000 a few years ago, now selling for $700,000. Recovery, impact, community. That's what we're all about here at the Bridge. I hope these words, recovery, impact, community, I hope you don't mind repeating that, resonate with you, give you a clear sense of what we hope our work would reflect in our guests and our community, and inspire you. We are keenly focused on making progress. My vision is that progress is made to happen through three concepts: leadership, education, and communication. Leadership, also known as motivating or inspiring, empowering others, is essential. Leadership. Strong leadership is a function of knowledge of self, your passion, and your flock. Here at the Bridge, our board of directors, myself and other members of the Bridge team, have to engage our partner organizations, our donors, and our volunteers to create progress. Progress can be said to be a result of education. Staff at the Bridge must see education as an ongoing process, constantly hoping to better understand our guests' challenges day to day, placing ourselves in the best possible position to help them recover. We must also educate our guests about the numerous resources available to them and how those resources might fit their individual and unique needs. And we must prioritize educating the community about homelessness, the amazing work we are doing on our campus every day, and the many ways that they too can participate in the progress being made guest by guest. Communication is also another key component of progress. I tell my team that we can always get better at our work, and we cannot do this work by ourselves. This results in expectations that we are good listeners, prepared, and solution-focused. We have made significant strides in how we share information about the Bridge, how we collaborate, and how we engage challenges. We want to model for our guests what progress looks like. Our dedication to leadership, education, and communication has helped us become a national leader in homeless recovery, but as we all know, there is much more work to be done. The city recently identified a shortage of 20,000 housing units in Dallas, that not enough affordable and permanent supportive housing exists for our guests, along with growing poverty in Dallas, has created a challenging bottleneck in our homeless response system for our guests. We have people living in the Bridge's transitional housing with voucher and few opportunities to make use of them. If our guests had access to housing, their transitional beds could be occupied by our guests in our emergency shelter, and our unsheltered individuals could occupy those emergency shelter openings coming onto our campus, feeling safe and secure, and off the street. It's pretty simple. The answer to homelessness is a home. So our board of directors and my leadership team have been engaged in discussions about establishing partnerships with landlords and property owners in our community, trying to develop housing units for guests transitioning from our campus. We don't have anything specific to announce today, but we're optimistic that our conversations will lead to a project, and once it's finalized, we'll reveal our plans and let each of you know how you can help us make those plans become a reality. Before I plug our big fundraiser coming up later this year, I want to quickly mention how meaningful my selection as president and CEO is as an African American man. As you may know, over 60% of the guests we serve are African American men. I take seriously the inspirational role and responsibilities I must manage daily. And for our guests, I always want to model that they too can plan, improve, and achieve goals they would establish for themselves. And I would humbly contend that this orientation is extremely important for all of our guests who engage in the process of recovering from homelessness and finding a home of their own. And so again, thank you to the Board of Directors of The Bridge for giving me the opportunity to serve as The Bridge's leader. I'm excited about our organization's future and all the amazing accomplishments we will have under our belt in another decade. Finally, we appreciate everyone making the choice to be here today to help us celebrate this major milestone. We want to personally invite you to join us on Thursday, September 20th, 2018, at our 10th anniversary fundraiser to be held at the Bomb Factory in Deep Ellum. I would like to take a moment to thank one of the members of our board of directors, Thomas Hartland Mackey, and his wonderful wife, Nasiba, for chairing the September event. Thomas, your family's support of our mission has been crucial to our organization, and we thank you for all you have done and continue to do to support our mission. So thank you. So again, thank you for all the support, your encouragement, and for joining us on this momentous occasion. At this time, I would like to invite attendees to join us for a brief reception in the courtyard behind me. And please take a moment to take a look at our new donor wall. Bridge guests, volunteers are ready in the pavilion with some celebratory treats, and thanks to our amazing donors, you will also have cake tonight with your dinner. And so, again, we thank you. We are in the awesome position, the powerful position to help an individual, male, female, who would be homeless. We are about recovery from homelessness and helping folks find a home. And with that, thank you.